You're at 45015 Van Dyke of Utica, Michigan.
Never asked why he started dating so soon till we had this conversation. The way he tells it, it's like it happened to him. This was not what I expected.
So I'm at the bar, and I have my back to the windows, and all of a sudden I hear pounding on the window. And I turn around, and it's somebody I don't know, and they are motioning for me to go outside. I go outside, and they instantly start kissing me. Don't ask me why.
What?
Yeah, maybe they had had a little too much to drink.
Wait a minute. This
yeah, just
harassment.
Out of the blue.
You're telling me a woman kissed you from seeing you in a window?
Yeah, through the window. Yes.
This woman was a complete stranger, and to my eye, I read her book. To my dad, this felt like a meet cute when Harry met Sally. Not long after that, floodgates opened. We started dating. Again. My mom, good friends, mom's first cousin. C-SPAN anchor everyone. He literally, he asked a woman out, he met it across the room. When I think of my dad,
but I don't think it's really relevant to you.
it turned out to be a bridesmaid. He rolled up in an area rug so that just her head was popping out. Thankfully, she was in on the bit. He proceeded to bob her back and forth between his arms like the way you see guys on the boardwalk try to juggle a stick between two other sticks. And then, unfortunately, he stuck an empty beer bottle through the zipper of his pants and pretended to pee. Everyone was laughing, but it wasn't funny. It felt scary to see him like that. My brother, my friend's uncle, and I raced into the house, and we dragged him out across the giant lawn. He started putting on this baby voice, saying, "You know, want to stop having fun," just begging us to go back to the party. We finally got him to agree to go home. And as he was getting on the bus, he turned to us and asked if we would hold his camera equipment for a second so he could tie his shoe. The moment our hands were full, he did a fake out. And he took off running back across the lawn, jumping over hedges to get to the party, yelling, "I'm free, I'm free!" It turned out the hedges were filled with poison ivy, which landed him in the hospital the next day. I didn't know until we talked that this moment changed something for my dad. He realized,
"What am I doing here? Maybe I'm a little out of control." And I started to say, "I better bring it down a couple of notches."
So that night really was kind of this turning point for you, huh?
I think so. That was certainly one that slowed me down, and which I needed at that point.
I really do think that was also a big moment for me, because it was just the moment that I really gave up. I was just like, I can't control this man anymore. It doesn't feel good to do that to you, and I also simply can't. I don't think anyone can. One of the reasons I wanted to talk to you is because I think when Mom died, we just grieved her very differently, you know? I really was hell-bent that, you know, you were grieving wrong and I was grieving right, and, you know, I'm kind of like embedded feeling and you're not feeling to my eye how I was.
I think it was just a different process for me, and I felt the grief, but I also felt this compulsion almost to be the funny man, to live a little bit.
He got this idea, I was surprised to learn, from someone at my mom's wake.
A woman who had lost her husband not that long ago. 14, 15 months earlier, she came up to hug me, and I remember asking her, "When does it get easier?" And she just said, "It doesn't." And that said it all.
So we decided, why not enjoy life? And all those times I thought I was being helpful and protecting him, I was actually making things worse.
I think, what made me a little angry at times was how you wanted to control me and control my emotions, and they weren't controllable.
Yeah. Would you say I treated you kind of like a child?
No, maybe just a little bit, but you were trying to kind of keep me on the rails, keep me in a straight and narrow. I felt like you were trying to say, no, this is how you have to feel. This is, you know, you have to be very sad.
Yeah. And what did you feel about me and how I kind of handled it and did it?
Well, you were pretty consistent in not liking anything.
Were you worried about me?
Very much so. Yeah, when someone's sleeping in their closet, I think that's cause for concern.
From your perspective, from where you were at, did you feel like I was grieving wrong?
Yeah, I guess I did. I mean, I didn't feel like it was, the most noble thing to be sleeping in your closet for over a year.
You were very disturbed by that.
Yeah, I thought it was.
Friends.
I thought it was disturbing.
I know, but isn't it funny? At the time, I thought there's nothing weird about this at all. It's not weird at all that I found the twin size mattress in the garage of my building, and I have it sticking like half in the closet, half out. And before I would go to bed, I would just take a swig of this NyQuil every night, and then I would go through her date book. She, you know, just to see your handwriting and to see kind of all the upcoming events. It's almost like a mystery you want to put together. And I think, oh, you know, it's St. Fletcher's graduation and doctor's appointments. And you're just kind of like,